We're delighted to be here. We're just going to lay down our load for the moment. We've got our boots on. We've got our gear on. We're ready for the journey. And in sharing the journey, we want to share some tips and strategies with you to help you on the journey of life. Barbara, can you believe we actually climbed that mountain?
No, I certainly can't.
Because facing that mountain is a bit like standing here facing all of you. This is not a normal place for us to be. And I suppose in any journey where we step out, we face our own uncertainties and doubts and fears. And to put Mount Kilimanjaro into perspective, if you see here, we've got Mount Kosciuszko on the bottom, we've got Mount Kilimanjaro, and then we've got Everest. So Kilimanjaro is the highest freestanding mountain in the world. We went there, and we actually wrote a book about it because we wanted to share some of our learnings on that journey. Because stepping out into the unknown is a big journey in itself. And each one of you will have faced your own journeys, whether it's stepping into a new job, whether it's starting a new relationship, whether it's finishing a relationship or being made redundant. And in each of those journeys, I suppose we have to reach inside of ourselves and find out, that's where we find out just what we're capable of, because that's where we check the boundaries of the possible. And sometimes we've got limiting beliefs about those boundaries. So stepping into the unknown, Barbara and I decided it was one of those bucket list things where we decided that we wanted to climb Mount Kilimanjaro, not ever realizing just what we were taking on. And when we got there, it was like, oh my God, are we actually going to do this? And it started off because as educators, we educate leadership in the corporate world and in the private world. And we had done some work in Nepal, leading some trekking exhibitions for leadership. And we decided we would do that in Kilimanjaro. So this was a way to do the journey beforehand. But having done it, we said, no way. We were too busy surviving, no matter running a leadership program up there.
So. Well, we set off to climb the mountain, and I failed. I didn't make it to the top. And the morning we set off, I had a little bit of swelling in my hands, a little bit on my face, and I mentioned it to the guide, and he said, no, you're right, keep going, so that's okay. So we set off, and that was at 4,600 metres we started that morning. Walked for 6.5 hours, and I took my glasses off when we sat down for lunch, and it became obvious to everyone else that I wasn't doing so well. So there's a conversation going on there about me. And then the guide came and said to me, Barbara, you've got to go down. I'm going, I don't think so. I came here to climb it. So he said, all right, well, you can go for another half an hour up to Stella Point, which is the rim of the crater. And I did that. And he said, okay, now you've got to go down. And I don't know if any of you have suffered from altitude sickness, but it's rather like being drunk. You're sort of pretty much out of it. You're not really with it. And so I said, okay. And my husband, Peter, said, he'll come with me. And I said, okay, whatever. Because, you know, I was pretty much out of it. And not taking into account for a second the enormous sacrifice that he was actually making, because he could have well made it to the top. But he said he'd come down with me. Now, coming down took another 2.5 hours to come down. And by the time I almost got there, I could hardly walk. And I just said to the guide, I can't go any further. And he said, okay, you can sit down for a moment. And it was literally a moment. He said, okay, you've got to get going. And I said, I can't. Just leave me. Just let me sit for a bit longer. And he said, you have to get up, because if you don't, you'll get cold. And then we can't carry you, so you've just got to do it. So Peter helped me struggle up to my feet and continue down. We got to the tent, and I just collapsed into it. Peter took my boots off, covered me up, and left me to it. They gave me diuretics, and you know what happens when you have diuretics, and this was to sort of drain the fluid because I was all blown up. And, of course, it's pretty barren out there. There's not a lot of places to go. And I don't actually mind because I'm a country girl, but the porters were just outside. And I already had this huge sense of failure, humiliation, embarrassment about not being able to make it to the top, to come down to the tent. And So Peter and I devised this thing where we got a drink bottle, and thankfully it had a wide neck. And he's holding me, and I'm sort of, you know, juggling, and, you know, it just really added to my humiliation. And I don't think I've ever felt so vulnerable or as exposed that night. And it was a failure, but what I got out of it was the connection with my husband. My beautiful husband's up there. And that strengthened our relationship in a way that I don't know that it would have happened any other way, because it just really deepened it. So that, you know, in a sense of a failure, but it was also a connection that was really, really important. And, you know, vulnerable, we all hate being vulnerable. No one wants to be vulnerable. But actually allowing yourself to be vulnerable and putting up your hand, or just even letting someone help you, is actually a strength.
And what Barbara is talking about is some of the values that we hold. And I think of values like a compass. They guide our behaviours, they direct our decision making, and they get us the results that we have on any kind of journey. So Barbara spoke about connections, vulnerability, and some of these words you might connect with them as well. These are some of the things that I hold to be important. So we have connections, courage. On some parts of that journey, it was about just stepping out and keep stepping and letting go expectations. And I was reminded of why I decided to live with more courage. Was my baby son died when he was a baby. He died at birth. His name was Alexander. And I suppose at that time, I didn't know that I could actually get through the next few hours, no matter the whole day. And what I learned from him, he gave me an immense gift. And that gift was understanding that we have a very precious gift, the gift of life. And we can choose to keep it wrapped up carefully and put it away safely, or we can choose to open it up and decide, maybe I'll just check out what I'm capable of, what's possible in the world. And that's how we actually get to understand what we can do. So I'm very grateful for Alexander, because he has given me that beautiful gift. And this saying by Nietzsche, he who has a why to live for can bear almost any how. And I think that's how we set adversity and challenge into perspective, when we can take meaning out of the things that happen to us, like Barb did on the mountain.
Now, another important thing that came out of that night was a choice. Because I could continue to see that as a failure, that I didn't make it to the top. Or was it a success? Was it a success, the deepening of the relationship with Peter, with Dolores? And was it a success that I actually climbed 5,730 metres? I say yes!
Well, you did.
And I have tremendous admiration for Barbara, because at that point, when she had altitude sickness, she was still continuing to, she wanted to keep going. Even though her face looked like a big melon, her arms were all swollen up, she did not look good. And I thought, this is, and she was saying, no, I'm still going. And the guide said, if you go up, you will die. Somebody actually died on the summit when we got there. And it brings home the preciousness again of life. And this is a very beautiful woman. She's a leader of the Maasai tribe that we went to visit. And in Africa, they have a saying. They say Sahu Bono. And Sahu Bono means I see you. So in a conversation, when a person, you're not actually allowed to converse or go into the conversation till you say Sidona. And Sidona means I'm here. So when you're fully present in the conversation, then we can actually connect. Then we can let our masks down. And I noticed that in Africa, there was that genuine connection where people took time to just see each other, connect with each other, and be present, where sometimes we get so busy, we don't do that. And this is a picture of my beautiful dad. He was diagnosed with Alzheimer's. And I'm not sure if some of you have experienced that very cruel disease that just steals your loved one away. And my dad, during the times when we sat quietly together, he wasn't quite sure who I was, But I used to tell him about, remind him of the stories when we were children, and he'd swing us high and he'd do different things with us. And he was a young, vibrant, fit, strong, healthy man. And we'd be all squealing for more time with him, more swinging, etc. And with Alzheimer's, it was what I found was love that actually connected us through that barrier. He knew that he was loved. And he knew that there was a deep, deep connection there. So it's about taking that time just to be present in the moment with your loved ones.
Now, this saying by Confucius that says, our greatest glory is in never failing, but rising every time we fall. And I have to say, I've had a few falls in my time, and I'm going to share some of them with me. But I just want you to do this with me for the moment. And these are seconds of time. Now, Dolores was talking about seconds of time with her dad. We had seconds of time on the mountain, and your life can change in a second. And my life changed 3 times in 3 seconds. The first time was 22 years ago when I was diagnosed with multiple sclerosis. Now, at that time, I couldn't see real well and I couldn't walk real well, but I knew it was a degenerative disease, and I actually made a choice at the time, so choice comes back in. So the choice I made was, I know I've got that disease, but I'm just going to park it there. I know what might happen, but right now I'm just going to live every day for the moment and not live my life in fear and not worry about what might happen. The other thing I did at the same time was I did a lot of meditation, a lot of healing, visualisation about healing it. Now, I can't say if they got it wrong or I healed myself, but all I can say is that's what happened and I don't have it. So there you go. The second thing that happened was the death of my grandson. Hamish died at 28 days old. He was born with a congenital heart disease and he made a difference to everybody around him. Now, how can you say this little tiny baby who didn't do anything very much, how could he make a change? But what he did was he taught us what's really important. It's about love, it's about family, it's about support, it's about connections. All of that together, he taught us, and we are better people because of him being here. Now, the third thing, and definitely the most difficult thing that I've faced, was the death of my son. He died last year in a water skiing accident, and he was just one of those magic people. I swore I wouldn't do this. When he was killed, again, I had a choice about how I dealt with his death. Now, I could think, why him? Because he was a beautiful man. Why did he leave 3 little children? You know, why did that happen? So I could have really got bitter and twisted about it. Or I could have thought, and I do think, wasn't I lucky to have this wonderful man for 34 years in my life and watch him grow and nurture him? Wasn't I lucky? And I choose to see that and to see the positive things that he brought. But in addition to that, actually live my life to the fullest and give every moment of my life to doing, making it, you know, what I can do to make it a better world because of him. And regardless, and everybody faces issues in their life, and it doesn't matter, you know, if it's a when, people will face it. But it's about how you deal with the things that you're confronted with and the choices that you make. And whatever happens, the sun is going to get up in the morning. And Joe had this beautiful CD in his boat, and he used to play it on continual replay, and I'm sure you'll know the song. It was U2's It's a Beautiful Day. Mm. And the words of that is, it's a beautiful day. Don't miss that beautiful day. So absolutely live your life to the max and enjoy those magic moments. And these are us enjoying some magic moments after we came down from Mount Kilimanjaro. So make sure you enjoy the beautiful day, because you never know when it's your last or what might happen. So enjoy it.
And 2 last messages. a message for myself is when you tap into your sense of purpose and values, it gets you through the tough times and it allows you to live in a meaningful way, to make a difference by who you are, because there's nobody else in the world like each one of you here. So it's about finding your song and singing it, because if you don't sing your song, nobody else can sing that song for you.
And for me, it's about having the courage and choose the life you want to live. As I said, you know, I had no choice about Joe's death, and I certainly would not have chosen, nor Hamish's death, or getting MS, or not getting to the top of the mountain. I wouldn't have chosen any of those things. But what I have chosen is how I deal with those things and how I respond to them, and taking courage from that to live my life to the most. And about being vulnerable, you know, it's actually okay to be vulnerable, and actually a strength to allow yourself to be vulnerable, because that's when the magic can start. And certainly with Peter and Dolores, it really did sort of bring that connection much, much stronger. And be strong and resilient and, you know, get out there and live your life to the full. So thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
By the time we're 60, more than 90% of us will have known someone close to us who has suffered from some sort of a neurological disorder.
You all know you're not going to live forever. There's only one way into this life and one way out.
I cannot prove to you anymore that anything is possible.
Talk about the marvelous thing that we now understand about our brains.
It gets so much better.